mathematics and so in this talk, I'm going to give a brief introduction or overview, let's say, of information secrecy in analysis. So the overall scope is not actually to teach you how to analyze the data, but to have a brief idea of what's going on behind the scenes and what information you want to get your presentations. In the first part, I'm going to give a very brief introduction about the sequencing classification. In the second part, I'm going to talk about primary analysis of sequencing and sequencing. Mostly it's sequencing, so don't worry, half the talk will be around here, and where the words should be done faster. And third part about the interpretation of the results, so some visualization, some analysis of the fields, some downstream analysis you can perform in your data. And finally, some online resources where you can actually find a lot of data and you will see there. So DNA sequencing mostly is based on the Sanger method, which is closely done to that. This was done at the late 70s, or I think 77, and around the end of late of 2000s. We can actually do this, only we can do this several years back. So, let's do that. Instead of having auto-radiomes, we have these nice pictures of single lumina figure. So, instead of auto-radiomes, we have this picture where it's nucleotide, which can be represented by a single color, and based on the density of this flow cell, this is a 40 million glasses flow cell. Normal ones are around 100 million, 150 million reads. So the final outcome of this right now is something like 100 million reads of around 100 million long reads. Okay. So based on the availability of information sequences, we have a lot of different approaches that you can actually seek in the end, so you have RNA-seq, TIP-seq, etc. But I am actually to perform analysis about the gene expression. It will give you general information about the gene expression, RNA biology, genome regulation, so it's mostly TIP-seq, the novel genome sequencing, genome organization, such as HiSeq or PiSeq approaches, transcription, so the off-track, translation and
replication. Sequencing, DNA sequencing that will give information on translation.
Okay. This is the only one I actually didn't know what what was the way it's working here.
Maybe Polish
Yeah, but even with RNA sequencing, going back to DNA sequencing, anyway, so in this talk, we're going to talk about RNA-seq and mostly chip sequencing. Okay. So chip sequencing will give you information about the genome-wide occupancy profile of either a transcription factor or exome modification, or whatever you are interested in. Let's do that. So the first step is fragmentation of your genome, so of your chromatin. This is usually done by instrumentation, so it's a random process. And then this is followed by an enrichment step. So you have an antibody that will select the fragments that you have either your PF or your modification or whatever genome feature you actually want to map to the genome. So once you have this, you prepare your libraries, the modification step, and then you just replace. The crucial step here is actually the enrichment step. So all the other is pretty much trivial. The main thing what is going to give specificity to your results is your enrichment step, so your chip. The better the chip, the better the results. That was the chip, that was the result. This is all the others pretty much equal to all the other aspects. So here you have a more graphical overview of this. So you have your chromatin, ideally you share your chromatin in smaller pieces. Discard all for a game on that. A lot. have your election slip, so only fragments that are actually bound by your DF are selected. This is magically read by your sequence set, and in the end you are going to have all these sequence fragments that will be mapped to the genome and will form this kind of pitch. So this is actually your final readout. So a bit of an approximation that is actually done here is that these overlapping reads will actually come from different cells. So you don't have more than two copies deriving from the same cell. So in GS, even though it's simplified as what happens once in the cell, it's not true. It's a population readout. So we have, I think, between 5 and 15 million cells that you are actually sequencing in each experiment. So this is something to actually keep in mind. The second interpretation, let's say, actually been in natural sequencing experiment, is that your primary sequencing data will not reflect the actual binding site. So your fragments, so this is your TF, let's say, this is your fragment, this is a binding position. What you want to see is this position here. What's actually happening is that your fragment will be of around 400 to 500 base pairs. So if your generation work fine. The sequencer will actually read only the 5' most piece section of your fragment. And this can be something between 36 nucleotides in early sequencer down to 100-120 nucleotides of current ASIC experiments. So what you're actually doing is that in order to find your actual binding site, you're going to normalize your forward reads and your reverse reads. So you will have a forward and a reverse density profile, which is your actual primary data, and you will perform a shift of these reads in order to have a combined density profile that will represent what you expect to be the result of your experiment. Okay. So, this is a field where you have some primary results of description factors, subsequencing data, and some T-SNE modifications. And you can actually see how specific and prone to interpretation are next-generation sequencing results, especially subsequencing. So, the beautiful thing is that we have this kind of highly accurate representation in a genome-wide manner, and you can have a highly accurate representation of the mistakes. This is fairly unbiased, since it doesn't actually rely on, depend on probes, positive probes, so any part of the genome is potentially sequenced. So you don't have any, let's say, restriction in what or where you're going to find the things. And finally, you can actually see that if you have several different features, you can have both complementary and overlapping information. So on the line, you can have several intersection factors finding you the same position or not. And you have complementary information, since you can actually see here that you have a careful translation profile, not in the description start site. Don't do that. And here you have the K36 translation profile, which is almost zero here, but it's finally in the model. So you will have this kind of overlapping information, of complementary information. So, just a brief overview of the workflow you can actually use to analyze your data. You start from your data, so raw data, so the output of the sequencer. You align your data. From this you are going to get two different readouts. So one is the read density profile, so the actual readout of the reads. And the second one is what you want to get, the second read. These are your peaks. Okay. So these are statistically significant, let's say, regions bound by TF or so the read density profiles will be very useful to visualize your results. Whereas in each regions, so your peaks will be useful to identify potential target genes and then perform structural analysis. Or you can also perform some overlaps between your TF and other TF or another TF or other genome your two target bands. So, you can do enrichment for motifs or potential DNA binding motifs that are physically bound by that compact.
So the previous slide, yeah, it's big enough here, corresponds to what? Corresponds to a region of DNA that is enriched in the property that was given in the CDP, right?
Yeah. So in each one of these, in each layer, what we get is this is the number, a pile up of reads.
Of reads, of how long reads? So 100 reads?
In this case, is 30. This case is, okay, this is 100. This is 51, this is 36, this is 100. Mm-hmm. But all these have been shifted. So this is why you actually get one single profile. In the raw data, you will get a double peak, which is the actual result.
So actually the sequence that is completed the sequence, mm-hmm. is that peak, you have to go to that peak and find what is the exact sequence that this transcription factor binds to that specific region, right?
Yeah.
So that sequence will be 50 base pairs or how long will it?
It depends.
It depends on the experiment.
Yeah. It depends on the experiment, it depends on your shearing, it depends on your factor. It depends on, so you can actually see that you will get to this level. So, your data will be in FASQ format. So this is what you're going to get back from your sequence of activity probably. What is FASQ? It's actually a FASTA format with void information, so void scores. So each read, each nucleotide will have a corresponding void score, which will tell you how confident the sequence was when it called this D or this A. Okay.
Well, that's the number, line number four?
Yeah.
That's the quality.
Yeah.
The gibberish.
Yeah, this is XXML.
Okay.
This is PHZ33. Okay. You have some standard formats.
There's standard
formats. You don't care about this.
Okay.
all of the algorithms you're going to use know how to do this.
Okay.
Okay. I accept how it works. So what do you do with that? Not much, generally, because it's not a sequence, this is not a map. Anyway, one thing you can do is, if you have some multiplex data, you can actually perform the multiplexing, so separate your different samples from one single local readout. And the second thing is the quality control of your actual experiment, so for actual sequence. So how to do that? Best way, only way I know now, is the use FastQC. FastQC actually performs a series of tests on your reads. So you have 14, let's say between 20 and 100 million reads like this. So this is a very small one. And this is what we get. So FastQC will actually go and read all of this. And we give you back some basic statistics as of how many reads we have, how many duplicates. It will check for the base quality, so for the overall sequence quality and for the per base sequence content. It will check for GC bias in your reads, uncalled nucleotides, the length distribution, this depends on the sequence platform, and we also check for overrepresented sequences and K-mer content. This is a good way to see if you have some adapters still remaining in your FASTQ file, or if you have some barcodes and things like that. Okay, this. If you find a lot of KMS in your sample, this means that you have get them out.
What is a KMS?
A KMS is a non-nucleotide, so it's an 8-mer.
Oh, okay. Any?
4 nucleotides, 5 nucleotides. So if you have usually adapters and barcodes are selected not to be easily found in your genome.
And you have the information on the FASTQ, it's not if the software will be like this.
You shouldn't find
FASTQ for its index.
you shouldn't have any adapters on it or any barcodes in your final customer, in what you are going to mount. Okay. Okay, usually you will see this in the alignment. So the most interesting statistic here is this. So these are two plots that we actually, these are, this is the distribution for each. Here you have 40 nucleotide long reads. So in each position. Here you have a distribution of the quality. So the higher the quality, the better the more confident you are. So this is a good example. So you can see that throughout your read, you have the same quality, or you can use all of your read, and you are confident that this is what the initial sequence was. If you get a picture like this, this actually means that half of your reads are thrown away. So you are not absolutely confident about what is happening from nucleotide 20 and on. You don't know what happened. So you can count the NA, but it could be a T, it could be whatever. What you can do here is actually to trim your sequences, all your sequences, 20 nucleotides, and then mark your 20 nucleotides.
So this is an average of the millions, of the 20 million or whatever.
Okay. Yeah, across all your sequences.
So you should trim everything there, because there will be several that are good actually, also at the end, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, several reads are fine. Not all of them are bad.
Yeah, probably yes. You could trim them based on the pair sequence quality. The problem is that in this case, you will find yourself having reads, unequal reads. Mm. So some reads will be 20 nucleotides long, some reads will be 30, some reads will be 35. This is not a problem anymore. It was a big problem around 2010, because most aligners wouldn't work with multiple, with reads with multiple aligners.
One more question. So if you do the same thing with ion torrent data, for some weird reason, the quality is lower. Even though the real quality is not bad, but in this QC plot, it seems that the bars are on the pink area. Do you know why this is happening?
We are here.
Yeah, for some reason, ion torrent.
I don't use fast QC because I know what is going on when I lie. To be quite honest, but so this is more okay. This is something that we actually get also in automatic. You will have a report from the sequence.
Yeah.
So this is very important if for chip check. It's not so important from certain point of view. If you're doing SNP analysis or things like that, this becomes very important. If you do clip check, if you're doing things that you will have smaller reads or maybe an ASIC, there you are. You have to be confident for every basic code. Okay.
This is for the software,
this
is based on because the read.
Yeah, this.
Always secure the data, no matter how it's into the quality. It's very good.
The one problem would be the fact that ion torrent doesn't give you actually standard reads.
Yes.
You will have a distribution of length.
Lengthwise.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So you will have a reads of 10 nucleotides and reads of 250 nucleotides. Mm-hmm. So I don't know how fast you see actually will carry this data. So it will. So this has a sense because each nucleotide has the same
length.
Yeah, the same number of reads. So all your reads will have for the.
So maybe fast to see if it is an empty position, it gives a bad value.
Yeah, it's most
probably. But if it aligns things that are short and long, then you have empty position.
Yeah. So if this would be 250 long, and you have 10% of 20 nucleotide long reads, everything that is beyond will be penalized because of the reads at this point. So probably you should send the. On your reads, and then assign an N. Probably this is what it does actually. You would take the longest read and you would assign an N.
And then it's back.
To N is not back.
I don't know. So probably
I don't know.
Yeah, from the different distribution. So do you get the same number of fish from every bee?
Yeah. I thought the place works in a different way than Illumina. It usually underestimates the score. So for Iron Torrent, the best score is always below 30.
Exactly, so it's in the big area, yeah.
25 to 28, let's say. But the way that they calculate the threat score, they call it threat score, but it is actually calculated in a different way.
Yeah, but you can actually change that. It's a threat 33 and threat 40. Yeah. And, if you can change that, it's not a problem. Anyway, I don't know.
And what about the rest of the tests? Should we, because some of these tests will fail always.
Yeah, these ones.
Yeah, I don't know, some of them fail always.
Αυτό μας έδειξε τώρα το pervasive plus quality, το δεύτερο.
Yeah. It depends on what phase. So if you find a camera content and you have a GF that binds, I don't know, something very specific and you find that on your reads, it's a good thing. Okay. But okay. Generally it has also a database of known adapters and known barcodes. So if you see something that's assigned as a barcode but assigned as a as a whatever. Anyway, I rarely do that. It's been a couple of years I don't run this. It's a couple of hours to go on. Okay. And you will get some statistics from the sequence of various.
So, okay,
so let's align this area. Actually do fast QC is because most of these biases we will actually see them when you have a bad read. So a bad read will not lie. A bad quality, a read with bad qualities will not pass the thresholds of the alignment. So that's not so much the reason to do that. Unless you have really big problems, you need to trim, whatever, but this is not the case. So, in order to align your data, you need an aligner or a mapper, which is an algorithm that takes each one of your reads and will tell you where it maps. Since 2007, you have a plethora of mappers. And the second thing you actually need is a reference genome. This could be a human or mouse, and you can get this from genomes, which is provided by Illumina directly. And they are pretty straightforward. You can get the indexes to the RRI, it's okay. Otherwise, you can learn from the UCC, it's BI, BI, or whatever. This is not the only thing that is standard for the raising. So these are really large, these are 20, 30 gigabytes long. And every different mapper will actually use a different index to try and align on this. So don't go crazy with aligners. Find one that you like. And use that, otherwise you will get like half a tera only for references. In general, it will not make a difference in your final result. I have rarely seen different aligners giving more than 3 pixels difference in the final results. So my favorite is both IE2. Why? Because it's fast, it's versatile, it can align both per-end and single-end rings, it's very well documented and supported, and it works really well. So the first, here you will actually have your first indication of good or bad experiment, which is a percentage of alignment. So all aligners will give you a percentage. Now, there's no case that you will have 100% of alignment rate. Usually what you will get something between 60% and 90%. Okay. So what happens if you have a low percentage? So this actually means that you either have contamination in your library to begin with, or you have some adapters that remain in your sample, or barcodes, you didn't treat them well, or, and this happens a lot, you are aligning the wrong reference. So you have a mouse sample, you are aligning best fit in the mouse. This is the best case scenario, you just change the reference and everything works. If it doesn't, it means you have a bad library. So everything below, let's say, 20% or 50%, it's a bad library. If you have 100 million reads, so you are allowed with 10, 15 million reads, it could go on. But it depends why. It depends on why you have a bad library. You can have a very small amount of DNA or many things. Anyway, it's not a good sign, let's say. So once you have your underlying data, this will be in some arm of the format. I mean, I'm not going to get into details, but we don't have time. So what you want to extract from this are your regions for your picks. What does it not do that? You perform a peak calling. This is a very naive representation of a peak calling. So these are, let's say, these are your intensive files. So some files, anyway. You just put a threshold and you say everything above this. So this will be, let's say, 20 reads. This is 15 reads. And this is 10 reads. So everything below 20 reads is a peak. Everything below is not. So what you will keep is your chromosome, your star and star position, an ID for HP, and the score. This score will reflect how many reads you actually have, your actual HP, so how many reads you have, in order to call this peak. In the end, you have a set of genomic coordinates that somehow represent your initial yes. What can you do? So many questions now, how many peaks, where do you have these peaks? School, so you have any other PS binding there, or is it in PSS? Whatever, what's the function? Okay, I don't know. What we're going to try in the, where we try to show you now, is how you can actually get this set of coordinates. Okay. So, based on Wikipedia, decoding is a computational method used to identify areas in the genome that have been enriched with aligned reads. Okay, is it easier said than done? Why? Because not there is no one single peak shape. So if you actually look here, if we're going back to your question, you can actually see these are all subsequent in frame. But you will have very different peak shapes. So transcription factor, we have a very narrow and sharp peak. Kehota methylation can have either a wider or another peak. K36 will map pretty much along the peak body, so we will have anything between the KBs and the KBs.
What exactly is on the y-axis? Absolute number of reads?
Yeah.
So again, from experiment to experiment,
yeah.
If you have many millions, you can be high, or if you have fewer millions, you can be low.
Yeah.
If your total reads.
So this is not the only problem, because you will have a different number of reads, you will have a different peak distribution, different peak heights, even within the sampling, and a different range of measurements. So you will have libraries that have, so experiments that have 10 million reads, and experiments that will have 100 million reads. And the same color should be equally in everything this is happening, and you will also have another variation between your samples. So some of the solutions for this problem is to use different colors to optimize the parameters you actually use to call your peaks. Use a correct experimental design, and we will come back on this later on. And again, having a good chip always helps. So before going on, just to show you what this actually, these different colors and this optimal environment means. Let's say you have a very optimal chip signal. So here we have something like 300 reads. Okay. You can easily see you have 5 reads. Okay, let's say 5.5, something like that. So if you cannot see a peak, it's not a peak. If you can see it, it's not so standard that every color will see it. Okay. But it's always good to see. If you see it, it's probably there. So, here you have the results
for three different picolers, so picoler 1, picoler 2, and this is the same picoler run with different parameters. So as you can see here, the first two picolers actually nicely identify 5 peaks here. The third picoler with these parameters will show you that this one single peak and another one here, so 2 peaks. If you play a bit with how wide or how narrow you want your peaks to be, you will have something, I don't know how many. Okay, so you will have your 5 plus some additional lower peaks. This you could actually filter out by using higher threshold for your p-value or for the number of peaks. But this could also be real peaks in a way. So this is something like 20 peaks. A lot of peaks would be like this. This is the scale. Anyway, so this is one region of your chipset. If you go to another one, so here, you have two large peaks and two smaller ones. The first one will identify 2, not this 2. The other 3, no matter what, will identify 1 single peak, all of this. If you now go to another place again, you have 6 peaks, let's say. The first one, which was your best one until now, will identify 3. You will use this 2. The second one will identify 1 peak here, 1 peak and 1 peak. So it's probably working a bit better in this region. Okay, this one doesn't work. You have 1 in this region. And this is probably working a lot better. If you don't mind some background. Okay, so what I want to say here is that in the end, your peak will represent only a summary of your chipset experiment. Okay. The main result is this.
Not just a summary, an interpretation of your chipset experiment, I
would say. Yeah, this is what we're going to use in order to.
You said the threshold, which is a threshold.
Yeah, but it, so the main problem is that you will not have one single peak color performing equally well along all of your samples. Okay, it's good to have a good peak calling, but in the end you will have a summary. You're going from a 10 gigabases data to 10 kbs, to 100 kbps. So you will lose all the information. Okay.
Anyway. Which peak colors are those? The
Quest, Max, and Slicer.
Quest?
Quest is a big loss. It's not
the first one, then it's Max.
Yeah, this is Max, Max 1.4. And this is Sizer by default, and this Sizer is modified parameters. It works pretty well. Sizer with modified parameters works pretty well also. Yes. Okay, you can filter out. So you just put a threshold on the list or your p-value. The bad thing is that you have to rerun all over again, because you cannot filter. You don't have this information in your results.
Max
2
is similar to Max 1.4. Max 2 is similar to 1.4.
It actually uses the same background with some other values, mm-hmm. like IDR and differential peaks. But overall, the algorithm behind is the same.
Does communication efficiency affect this, the peak calling, or is this taken out when you make the language sort of normalized?
I don't think it actually affects the
fragments.
Probably it does, on how sharp your peaks will be here.
Or if you have smaller peaks on either side. Because if you have bigger fragments that get pulled down by the antibody.
Yeah, so you will have you will have a different picture here. So only a bad communication won't be able to discriminate between these two peaks. It will only give you one peak, but you don't really know that. So it's not a big color. So, you can use, there are some useful metrics you can actually use to test your peak color or your peaks generally, which is the fraction of reads in your peaks. So, the 20 million reads you have in the beginning, how many reads do you have in your actual peaks? Okay, so for a pro, this threshold is over 1%. If you have 1% of your reads in your peaks, you are quite good, which is very low. patterns, but it's closer to, but you will have a lot of things that will be like that.
So that's like a polygon control?
Yeah. I don't like
it. You would like higher? Or not?
Yeah. Ideally, you would want some flex at 10%. Okay. But this depends very much on your chip. So you will have a lot of background. The better your enrichment, your initial enrichment, the higher this fraction will be. Okay. Another one is the IDR, it's the irreducible discovery radius used by Max2. In order to have this, you need to have replicates. So this actually penalizes peaks that are found only one of the two replicates of your chip. And you can also some significant metrics. This can be the peak value, the chip to input ratio, the number of reads used to call the peak, etc. Apart from that, there are some empirical ways. So if you know the motif that is bound by your transcription factor, you can expect it to be an H in your fix and also to be in a central position. You can look at the distribution. So if you have a K4 translation, you expect it to be mostly in the other transcription subsides. If it's a K36 translation, you expect it to be in the gene body. If it's a K27 translation, you expect it to be in enhanced. If you have an experiment with K36 translation, that maps pretty much everywhere. You either have a problem or an edge effect somewhere. Another thing is you can assign your potential target genes and see if you see any gene expression changes, any correlation with the inflation changes or functional notation. So these are pretty much empirical. Be aware that once you select your picks based on these kind of things, you actually bias your sample towards there. So if you select your picks as those that have this motif, you cannot go in the paper and say, oh, my DF binds there. You select it. Okay. You can do it, but be aware of it. And the best thing is to inspect your data in the browser. So go and look what the decoder actually gave you back.
Well, you cannot do that. I mean, you cannot do that really on a regular basis. You have to analyze 100 chipset
data. No, you can't. Well, I have. People here will have one TF and you will have your data.
I mean, chip is not the money process there.
Okay, these are pretty much automated. This is very bad for me. Here you can play, but you will have a lot of variation between samples.
So this significance, can you do it for one sample, or do you have to have replicates? You said for the IDR you have to have replicates.
Yeah. No, significance is per sample.
So even significance p value, you can find some kind of p value per sample.
Yeah,
what does it mean?
It's how it's calculated based on the overall distribution of your reads and on the ratio with your input. It's this is calculated by the column.
So whether a peak is a real, the p value that a peak is a real peak.
Okay, so this is the best way. You cannot do it for 100. Okay. But you will have other methods. But it's not on this talk. Okay. So, cut a very long story, not so short. I use Max for PFs and Sizer for X modifications. Just as an example, fast example, this is how you run Max. It's very simple, it's straightforward. You call Max, you give it your treatment, so your chip, your control, which is the input, the genome, so it knows how much is the background, and the name of your sample, of your run. This could actually run even if you only give him the treatment and the name. But you
it's very good to have an input. You will run without an input, it will give you picks, but I will draft them.
So the input has to be also a library, a read, a set of reads.
It's an OIP of your command. So, the output of Marx, this is one of the first outputs. This is the pick model. So here, if you remember from the, what we were talking about, the forward and the reverse reads. So here you have still distributions. This is the forward reads, this is the reverse reads, and this is the statistical model that Marx will actually find in your enriched regions. And this is what he's going to search for. This is, so this is 119. So what Marx found in this particular sum is that your forward and your reverse reads usually are 214 kilobytes. Okay, so this is how much Marx will shift your reads to get your combined profile. Okay, this means that you actually have reads. So this is how you read. If you see something like that, it's not very good. Okay, this actually, Marx will tell you that the optimal distance is 50 nucleotides, but this actually means that you mostly have background. So you will have random forward and random reverse reads. So it will give you something like that.
What is the third column? What is forward
combined? The combined, the shifted times.
The shift, which Marx does. He does the shift. Okay.
The problem is that Marx will run. If you don't look at it, it will give you probably, in this case, 10,000 pips. Okay, this is why you need to go back and see if the called pigs are actual pigs. Okay, they will have low scores, but it will give you pigs.
Okay. So, John, but you have to give Max the shift, or it calculates itself?
No, this is calculated by itself on the top 1,000 and it's pigs found based on the default.
So, if this is, for example, this depends on the fragment size, right?
No.
No?
No, the fragment size, theoretically, yes. The fragment size you will give, which depends on your communication.
Sorry.
By default, it's the kind of window, right?
Yes.
He assumes to have the kind of window.
So if it is with the kind of window, that you could skip, you would reject the following and the image below, right?
Yeah.
If it's 300 nucleotides that the shift or more or less like that, you would say, okay, this is not a peak because the shift is only 50 base pairs.
No.
Because he marks actually. It's on the enrichment. Yeah. The enrichment of the reads that you have in that position, in that specific peak, it's not. The sonication it's kind of helping, but that's not the determining factor. The determining factor is the type of read for the model to.
So this is so Marx will actually recalculate every time the optimal shift. You can tell him to run without an optimal shift and tell him, okay, I want to shift my reads by 150 kilobytes. Okay, you can do that. But this will mostly depend on how you're on the shape of the pitch. Okay. So a K36, you could expect this from a K36 experiment. Okay. Because you don't have so many reasons to have so many forward and reverse reads close together. Okay. So the results. You will also get an Excel file with all the arguments that actually Marx ran on. Here you have the bandwidth. So, well, this is fixed on 300. And here some words here. Okay, this here. And you will have some information about your reads, how long they were, what's the redundancy rate, etc. And then your pitch will be below that. So you will have your chromosome, start, end position, the length of the pitch. So each pitch will not be the same length. The summit, so wearing your peak, you have the highest point of ridge. The number of ridges, facts, is the number of ridges that actually Max used to call this peak. This is the value which is actually a score for Max. The whole enrichment, this is over your input. And the force score rate, which is, I think, by swapping input and input. Also, you get this red file. So your chromosome, start, stop, ID, and score. And, this is what you're going to put with your graph. So, also you will get a WIG file, which is a normalized density text format, which you will want to transform in a big WIG file, which is a binary file of this one. This is what you will use again using GeoGraph. Okay. So this is a big WIG. This is a bed. All of these are beds. And it's pretty much what you can, the first thing you should do after learning, after getting your results. So some general guidelines. It's good to have various guidance kits, at least two. Actually, maximum two, it's very good to have an input sample, which is a no-IP sample of your chromatin variation, possibly. This will take off a lot of noise because of the IP, because of accessibility, because of everything. So you will rule out that your peaks are actually there because it's a highly accessible region.
So every time you use a new batch of chromatin for a chip assay, let's say using the same antibody, you should do an input?
Ideally, yes. Okay, if it's the same kind of cells, probably you can use the same topic. Ideally, don't have to. Good 20 to 25 million reads per sample is very good. If you have more reads, don't do more replicates. Just do a kind of a... So, you don't need replicates for choosing. For an ASIC, yes. If you have to choose between a number of reads and replicates, choose replicates. For chipset, if you have to choose between replicates and reads, choose number of reads. Average of one single sample.
Yes.
The only reason you need replicates is to calculate the area. Optimize your chip condition before preparing your library. Minimize experimental variation, so use a, possibly use the same program to perform, so the same yeah. So program to perform different chips, especially if you want to compare them. And finally look at the data. So once you submit your data, your libraries, download and GPU. So here are some couple of papers on, for with some guidelines of 2012 and 2013. Okay, I'm going to skip an ASIC for good because we're not going to finish. Okay, it's a lot more straightforward. Okay, you have your data, you have your data, you just read, you have read counts for this condition if you want for differential expression, and then you call differential expression. What's happening here is probably the most interesting part. Limit a different aligner, so because it's a spaced aligner, I use that, it's very fast. If you want to use GAFLinks, you have to use Docta. I don't know. GAFLinks is a suite for distribution analysis, downstream, so differential expression and things like that. I personally don't use it, but if you want to use it, you have to use Docta. Start will take 2 hours, what will take today, more or less. Okay, you can, in order to count your reads, you can use a sig count, and for different expression, you can use a jar and the sec. They both work pretty well, and they work in our environment. So one, what I was talking about before, so let's say you have four different samples, and you want to have eight replicates. Don't use an experimental design like that, because all of your samples in each of your groups will have exactly the same bias. So try and have a randomized So randomize your sounds with respect to the flow set. So I design like that, or ideally bulk open. So here you will have 32 replicates with the same number of reads, and this will give you a very high confidence on logistic analysis output. And you can also normalize across flows. With your same sounds, you will have different effects. Okay, so moving on to the interpretation. Visualization. So how do you visualize actually your data? You can either have a local GeoM browser or use an online browser. Locally, a very good choice would be RGV, so Integrated Genomics Viewer. And online, they use using GeoM browser. Why RGV? It's cross-platform, so it's Java. So it will run on Windows, Mac, and Linux. It can support different file formats, and it's really fast. UCC is web-based, so it will run pretty much everywhere. It's low, especially if you need to upload all the data to the browser, but it has a very comprehensive database of both the genomic features of alternative data sets. It has all of the old data. The main problem is finding them.
What?
The main problem is finding where they have a really strange way of cataloging all these data sets. But once you get the handle, it's really good. So this is how it looks like. So this is RGB, this is Bigwig, this is a bed format, this is a BAM format. So here we have for all the best reads, you can see different things. And this is how UCC pretty much looks like. Here we have a lot of conservation and other features. An alternative to RGV is GenomeGraphs. It's an R package. It's not easy to use, but it will give you pretty nice figures after you pass a couple of weeks trying to understand how. But finally, if you want some application for the figures, it could give you some really nice exams that you can actually. If you know which regions you want, you have like 20 genes, you just put it down. It's very slow, but nice. For private online, in a couple of months, probably you could use IAMI if I develop. We'll talk about it in a couple of months.
Who developed?
You're IAMI. But it was easier than using GeoMeter. So someone else software, Galaxy, you can use a Galaxy server, it's an online collection of what you use mathematics tools. It comprises FastQC, both Arc, Affluence, and everything. We mentioned up now. To me, the main problem is that we actually need to learn how to use Galaxy. So I think it's easier. If you spend twice the time to learn Galaxy, you can actually learn how to download tools in command line. It's a lot better. And you can actually use it for many more things if you really want to. This is a Galaxy. And then Galaxy is a Chipster, which is a user-friendly analysis software for high-level data with a graphical user interface. And this will be actually presented in the next seminar by Joe. So moving on, downstream analysis. One good choice, GRAIT, which is a genomic agents and enrichment annotations tool. It's a Python annotation of system regulatory regions, so PIGS. It takes us an input, a bed file, and gives us an output, a list of potential target genes. The good thing is it actually allows you to use different like gene assignment methods. It will give you some big distribution plots, and finally it will perform some gene analysis of genome knowledge, pathways, and that. But I think we cannot put gene lists directly. You will have to put your picks and then he will start to do it nice. Otherwise, this part is really nice to play. Yeah. This is where you will find it. Another thing is Namecheap, which actually performs an optic discovery, enrichment, and classing analysis of your picks. But I think you cannot use it directly on that file. You need to into a faster file. You can use Galaxy to do this. It took me 2 days. You are the problem.
Okay,
probably now it's better. And we give you as an output the enriched motifs and some motif distribution plots. So here you will have your motifs. Here you will see this distribution within your peak. So it's what you would actually expect for your known motif to look like. And this is where you will find it. So going on to the last part, some online sources in code, which is a video of DNA elements. It's an international consortium with the aim to build a comprehensive facts list of functional elements in human genome. It doesn't have only human genome, it also has a mouse, and the model code now has also Drosophila and the word model. So, why they have a new website, which is really easy to use and really nice. So So they have this search box. You can pretty much put what you are interested in, and it will give you results that are pretty much like that. This is not the case for other databases. So right now, you can see it comprises both chip sequencing and sequencing, DNA-seq and other assays. It has something like 7,000 human data sets and 700 mouse data sets. And you can choose your targets such as modification, external factors, controls, and in several examples. So this is, you can actually click on that. And from this, so from the full database, with 3 clicks, you have 6 experiments, which are mouse, transcription factors, and are performing primary research. So here we have macrophages, fibroblasts, and whatever. If you click on this, you will have access to both the raw data, so fast to give more data, and also a series of process data. So, what you can do is, first of all, you can download the BigQuick files, so the signal, and load it directly to your genome browser, or download the alignments and the marks or whatever, or take the picks. I usually tend to download the data because you have a good control of what's going on afterwards. You have some really strict protocols in order to get to this. They are the same for everything. So all the 10,000 data sets here will be processed in the same way. So the same peak color, the same. Gene expression omnibus or GEO is a public function genomics data repository. It's very good because you have access to all the published data. Because all next-generation sequence data have to be deposited to GEO or to the European analog of GEO prior to publication. And they are publicly available for academic use. Their search is not so good. So the best way to actually query GEO is to use the accession number that is declared in the manuscript, and it will look something like that. And this will give you access, FTP access to SRA frame. So it's a binary format of a FASTQ file. So raw data, this is very good. And code is limited on the experiments that are performed only by encode. In GEO you will find both encode and all of the other published assets. European Nuclear Archive is the analog of GEO in Europe. So it's EMBI maintained, provides a comprehensive record of the work in the sequence information, it covers raw sequencing data, but also sequencing and send information and fraction annotation, so it's pretty much unfounded. The research button also is not so good. They have a large overlap with your database, so most of GEO and ANA data sets are shared between them, so you're later you will find it on both. And I'm going to close with that, saying that with all the data sets that are actually
the voice that I found here, we have a comprehensive database of genome features, and we can finally have some sustaining understanding of biological processes, which we likely need some integrated analysis and some simple analysis of this data. So thank you.
So I have a question that I guess is addressed to the bioinformatics support unit. So how much of this is going to be implemented in the pipeline that we will use by the bioinformatics support? First question, and the second part of the question rather is that are we going to get any training plan for working with this once the pipeline is decided upon?
An experimental galaxy server is already installed. That's true also for Chipster. So most likely everything that is being covered by your Giorgio will be available through bioinformatics facility. On the training, this set of seminars at the beginning have the purpose to define the field. And then there will be some more specific seminars or maybe webinars or maybe online tools just to focus on specific aspects of the pipelines and how to run those. Together with Georgia, we plan also, as you know, to have Ariadne also installed locally here.
The long time.
Yeah.
Maybe.
You know the answer.
No, but I am keen to see the George's experience and also the other collective experience by the members of the unit actually implemented in a pipeline so that, you know,
we know that
Max and Sizer or whatever work for specific data, this is what we should use rather than having to invent it with every time. That's my idea. Yeah.
What I actually eventually see as a long-term project would actually be a relatively easy to use front-end to play with the parameters. That's the thing again. Not running Max, it's not so difficult. It's easy to implement, it's easy to run. Problems start when you actually want to, you know, you cannot ask from the facility to have a very specific view of your data. So a lot will depend on what you will see. So if you remember from the first slides, a lot depends on what you want to see in the end. So you cannot tweak the parameters and then go back and check visually. This is something that whoever did the experiment and also knows all the bios behind all the problem, what he wants to see or not. So the basic idea would be actually to give him access, play with the parameters, and get relatively fast a bed file. Okay, the other one is it's already implemented in a way.